Let's talk about the causes of the conflict. I think if you're going to talk about the causes of the conflict, you have to come at it from three different perspectives. First of all, you have to ask, what are the deep causes of the crisis? What are the structural factors that underpin this conflict? Then you have to talk about the precipitating causes, because the crisis broke out on February 22nd, 2014. Things were not terrible until February 22nd, 2014. And that's when everything went to hell in a handbasket. And the question is, what caused it then? If you focus on deep causes, it can't tell you why something happened in February 2014, but the precipitating causes are designed to get at that. And then what we want to talk about is the Russian reaction, why the Russians did what they did with regard to Crimea, with regard to eastern Ukraine. We want to talk about exactly what they did and then why they did it. So let's start with the deep causes. My argument is that the West is principally responsible for this mess, not the Russians. This, of course, is not the conventional wisdom in the United States. And in fact, except for Steve Cohen, who's now at Princeton, I mean, now at NYU, he used to be at Princeton, Henry Kissinger, and maybe a handful of other people, there are not many people who agree with me. But I think the facts are quite clear on this, that the West is responsible. And my aim is that the main deep causes, the aim of the United States and its European allies, to peel Ukraine away from Russia's orbit and incorporate it into the West. Our basic goal has been to make Ukraine a Western bulwark on Russia's border. And Russia says, this ain't happening, period, end of story. And we will do everything we can to make sure it does not happen. That's the deep cause. Now, take it a step further. There are three key elements in our strategy. The first is NATO expansion, and in many ways, the most important. And I'll talk in some detail about that in a second. But as you all know, since the Cold War ended, starting with the Clinton administration, we have been moving NATO eastward toward Russia's border. And the Russians have said, this is an absolute no-no. And I'll walk you through the story in a minute. Second is EU expansion. EU expansion is all about integrating Ukraine economically into the West, the way we are in the process of integrating Poland, the Czech Republic, Slovakia, the Baltic states into the West. And of course, we're doing that with NATO as well. These are two sets of institutions, NATO, military institution, the EU, an economic institution. And the idea, again, is to take Ukraine, peel it away from Russia, make it part of the West. The third part of the story is fostering an orange revolution. This is all about promoting democracy in Ukraine and in other places. As you all know, the United States runs around the world trying to topple regimes and put in their place democratically elected regimes. And for almost all of you, me included, it's hard to be against promoting democracy. We all love democracy. But if you're Vladimir Putin, or if you're part of the leadership in Beijing, when the United States talks about democracy promotion, that means toppling your regime. And you won't be surprised to hear this. They don't like that in Beijing, and they don't like that in Moscow. Right. They do not like that. Right. The Chinese believe that we're behind the protests in Hong Kong. You go to Beijing, you talk to Chinese elites, the idea that we're promoting democracy around the world and especially in East Asia just drives them crazy because they think they're in the crosshairs. And you know what? They are in the crosshairs because our basic strategy is to topple regimes all over the world, not simply because we like democracy, but because we believe that whoever gets elected will be pro-Western. So we're killing two birds with one stone. We're promoting democracy and getting leaders who are pro-American. But again, you can see the strategy here, NATO expansion, EU expansion, and promoting democracy. I'll say a bit more about NATO expansion because it's so important. NATO expansion took place in two tranches. The first one was in 1999. That's when you get Poland, the Czech Republic, and Hungary incorporated into NATO. The second big tranche was in 2004. And that's when the Baltic states, you can see Estonia, Latvia, and Lithuania up top, Romania, Bulgaria, these are the light brown countries. That's the second tranche of NATO expansion. Now, the Soviets made it clear from the mid-1990s they were adamantly opposed to NATO expansion. But number one, they were too weak to do anything about it. And two, it didn't involve the states that were right on their border. I mean, there's no question, as you can see from the map, that Latvia and Estonia are on Russia's border, and Lithuania as well, if you want to include that little enclave between Poland and Lithuania. But the fact is, these were very small states. It was early in the game, and the Russians were willing to live with it. But then the big trouble starts. And it comes in the famous Bucharest summit, NATO's Bucharest summit in April 2008, where at the end of the summit, a declaration is issued which says, NATO welcomes Ukraine's and Georgia's Euro-Atlantic aspirations for membership in NATO. We agreed today that these countries will become members of NATO. The Russians made this perfectly clear. This was unacceptable. Russia's deputy foreign minister said, Georgia's and Ukraine's membership in the alliance is a huge strategic mistake, which will have most serious consequences for pan-European security. Putin himself said, Georgia and Ukraine becoming part of NATO is a direct threat to Russia. You all remember that there was a war between Russia and Georgia in August 2008? That war was a consequence of this, because the Georgians thought we were sending them a signal that they could get uppity with the Russians and we would back them because they were going to become part of NATO. That's not what happened. And you know what happened. The Russians clobbered the Georgians, and Georgia is in deep trouble today because it thought it could become part of NATO. So you want to remember that April 2008 summit, very important. That declaration, very important. And then what happens is you have a war. So those are the deep causes, those three strategies: NATO expansion, EU expansion, and promoting democracy. What about the precipitating cause? Key events leading up to the coup. It's the coup of February 22nd, 2014 that's of enormous importance. That's what really throws the crisis into gear. Just think about that word, coup. Orange Revolution, promoting democracy, the coup, February 22nd, 2014. So the question is, what causes the coup? It all starts in November of 2013. At that point, Yanukovych, President Yanukovych, who's the head of Ukraine, is negotiating with the EU to form an association agreement that brings the EU and Ukraine much closer together. It's a step in the direction of incorporating Ukraine into the European Union, or to put it in slightly different terms, incorporating Ukraine into the West. The Russians make it clear that this is unacceptable. The Russians are willing to do a deal that involves the EU, Russia, the IMF, and Ukraine. But the idea that Ukraine is going to do a deal exclusively with the EU and the Russians are going to be left out in the cold is not something that Putin is willing to countenance. He puts significant pressure on the Ukrainians. He offers them a terrific deal. And as you can imagine, the EU is not offering Ukraine a particularly good deal because you know how much corruption there is in Ukraine. And the EU wants Ukraine to eliminate that corruption, which the Ukrainians really don't want to do. So what Putin does is not only make it clear that that deal is not going to happen, but he offers a sweetheart deal of his own. So Yanukovych, on November 21st, says no to the EU. This leads to a series of protests. The Ukrainian government, truth be told, under Yanukovych, overreacts to the protests, which causes them to spiral out of control. And in January of 2014, you can see there, January 22nd, 2014, you have your first two deaths in the protests. These are the Maidan protests. And then in the February 18th through February 20th time period, lots of people die. It's really messy. And what happens is that a number of European foreign ministers, the German foreign minister, French foreign minister, they fly to Kiev, and a deal is worked out to have elections that will, in effect, remove Yanukovych from power. But the protesters refuse to accept the deal. And there are significant fascist elements among the protesters who are armed, right? There's killing on the Maidan. And as a result, Yanukovych flees for his life to Russia. And this all happens on February 22nd. On February 23rd, Parliament votes to repeal minority language laws in the East. This is basically the Russian language. And then on February 27th, Russian units begin seizing checkpoints in the Crimea. On the 28th, additional Russian forces begin moving into the Crimea. The Russians didn't conquer or invade Crimea. Actually, the Russians didn't invade Crimea. They were already there because they had a leasing agreement. There's a naval base at Sevastopol, and the Russians were leasing that naval base from Ukraine. So they had military forces there. So when it says Russian units begin seizing checkpoints on the 27th, those were Russian units that were already there. Then additional Russian forces begin moving in on the 28th. And then on the 6th, the 16th, and the 18th, you have a scenario, you have a handful of events that lead to Russia incorporating Crimea. And then, of course, shortly after that, conflict breaks out in eastern Ukraine. And although we do not have a lot of hard evidence that the Russians are physically involved in eastern Ukraine, I think it's quite clear that they are physically involved, that there are Russian troops there. How many is very hard to tell from the outside. I think it's very clear that the Russian government is going to great lengths to make sure that those pro-Russian forces in eastern Ukraine are capable of maintaining a certain amount of independence. And I'll talk more about this in a second. Okay, understanding the Russian response. What is the Russian response? Two parts. First is, they took Crimea, and they're not giving it back. Crimea's gone. Second is, what they're doing is not trying to conquer Ukraine. There are many people who say the Russians are going to go on a rampage, they're going to try and reestablish the Soviet Union or a greater Russia, and so forth and so on. That's not going to happen. Putin is much too smart for that. You remember what happened when the Russians invaded Afghanistan? You remember what happened when we invaded Afghanistan? You remember what happened when we invaded Iraq? You remember what happened when the Israelis invaded southern Lebanon? You want to stay out of these places. In fact, if you really want to wreck Russia, what you should do is encourage it to try and conquer Ukraine. Putin, again, is much too smart to do that. What Putin is doing is he's basically in the process of wrecking Ukraine, and he's telling the West in very simple terms, you have two choices. You either back off, right, and we go back to the status quo ante before February 22nd, 2014, where Ukraine is a buffer state, or you continue to play these games where you try and take Ukraine and make it a Western bastion on our doorstep, in which case we'll wreck the country. And they are, of course, now in the process of wrecking it, right? And they're going to keep this conflict going for as long as they have to. That's the basic game here. Again, two steps. One, took Crimea. No way they're going to ever let Crimea become a NATO base. And remember, the name of the game here is to make Ukraine part of NATO. Not happening. And they're not getting Crimea. We've taken Crimea. We're keeping it, number one. And number two, you want a frozen conflict or you want to wreck Ukraine so that it can't become part of the West. Question number two here is, what motivates this? What motivates this is that Russia is a great power, and it has absolutely no interest in allowing the United States and its allies to take a big piece of real estate of great strategic importance on its western border and incorporate it into the West. This should be hardly surprising to the United States of America. As all of you know, we have a Monroe Doctrine. The Monroe Doctrine basically says that the Western Hemisphere is our backyard, and nobody from a distant region is allowed to move military forces into the Western Hemisphere. I can tell from looking at the audience that most of you are old enough to remember the Cuban Missile Crisis like I am. You remember how we went stark raving crazy at the idea of the Soviets putting military forces in Cuba? This is unacceptable. Nobody puts military forces in the Western Hemisphere. That's what the Monroe Doctrine is all about. Can you imagine 20 years from now a powerful China forming a military alliance with Canada and Mexico and moving Chinese military forces onto Canadian and Mexican soil, and us just standing there and saying, this is no problem, we're all 21st century people, and worrying about Chinese forces there is what 19th century people like Vladimir Putin worry about. Of course that's not going to happen. We're going to maintain the Monroe Doctrine with regard to China just as we did with the Soviet Union during the Cold War. So nobody should be surprised that the Russians were apoplectic about the idea of us putting Ukraine on the western side of the ledger. And by the way, they told us. I gave you the quotes in the wake of the Bucharest summit. I told you what happened in August 2008 with the Georgia War. The precedents were there. The rhetoric was there. They told us. But we did not stop our efforts to make Ukraine part of the West. And the Russians responded. Was it surprising? For some reason, President Obama and virtually all of the elites in the West were surprised. I guess this is because they're 21st century people, right? And they think that balance of power politics doesn't matter anymore. If you think these people in Washington and most Americans are having trouble dealing with the Russians, you can't believe how much trouble we're going to have with the Chinese. I'm very popular in China. I go to China quite often. And I usually start my talks by saying it's good to be back among my people, because when I'm in China, I'm intellectually much more at home there than I am in Washington, because in Beijing, much like in Moscow, you're dealing with 19th century people like me, whereas in Washington, you're dealing with 21st century people. I think the Chinese are going to eat our lunch, right? Talk a bit about the conventional wisdom. Conventional wisdom is that Putin is the main cause of the crisis. Some say he's either crazy or irrational. Angela Merkel was making this argument for a while. He's bent on creating a greater Russia, and he bears marked resemblance to Adolf Hitler. I'll say a few words about each of these. I know a great deal about Adolf Hitler. I've written and I teach extensively on Nazi Germany's behavior in the 30s and during World War II. The idea that he bears any resemblance to Adolf Hitler is laughable in the extreme. It's hard to believe that serious people make that argument. The idea that he's bent on creating a greater Russia, I think if he could do it, he'd do it. He can't do it. Russia's a declining great power. And as I said to you before, if they were to try and create a greater Russia by invading Ukraine and by invading the Baltic states, they'd be jumping into the briar patch. In fact, again, if you want to wreck Russia, what you should do is tell them to try and create a greater Russia. It will lead to no end of trouble. I think Putin is much too smart for that, and he is in the process of wrecking Ukraine. I want to make that clear. And he's wrecking Ukraine because he's basically saying to the West, you can't have it, and I'll wreck it before you take it. Is he crazy or irrational? I don't think so. I think he's very strategic. And I don't think he's the main cause of the crisis, as I said to you. Another set of arguments associated with the conventional wisdom. This is that the United States is a benign hegemon seeking to promote European stability, seeking to promote stability in Asia, all over the globe, and so forth and so on. There's some countries like Japan and Germany, for sure, Poland, who view the United States as a benign hegemon. There are many countries out there who do not. Iran is one, China's another, and Russia's a third. They just don't see it that way. And because they don't see it that way, you should understand that when you take measures, you meaning the United States, that you think are going to be interpreted as benign, the other side will not see them that way. They will see them as threatening. This gets back to my point about democracy promotion. We believe democracy promotion is an unalloyed good. We can't understand why people like Putin and the leaders in Beijing don't understand this, but they don't understand it. And if you don't recognize what other people think, you're incapable of putting yourself in their shoes, you're going to get yourself into a heck of a lot of trouble. And of course, that's exactly what happened here. And then another argument is that Putin's behavior proves that it was wise to expand NATO eastward to try to include Ukraine and Georgia, right? What's very interesting is that there is no evidence that we thought Putin was aggressive before the crisis. There's no evidence that we thought that. There's no evidence that we were talking about expanding NATO because we had to contain the Russians. Because again, NATO expansion was driven by 21st century men and women. They believe balance of power politics is dead. That's what happened here. Do you understand? Putin is a 19th century man, right? He does view the world of balance of power in terms of balance of power politics, as do we when it comes to the Monroe Doctrine in the Western Hemisphere. But in this case, in the case of Europe, we were thinking like 21st century men and women. And we thought that we could just drive right up to his doorstep and it wouldn't matter. Right. We did not think that Russia was aggressive. What happened here is that after the crisis broke out on February 22nd, we then decided that Russia was aggressive. We then decided that Russia was bent on creating a greater Russia. It was after the fact. And by the way, this is why President Obama and virtually all of Washington was caught with their pants down when this crisis broke out after February 22nd, because they did not see it coming. talk a little bit about our response. We're basically doubling down. We're getting tougher and tougher with the Russians. That's our strategy. And that's exactly what you'd expect if you're going to blame them, given that we're incapable of blaming ourselves because we never do anything wrong. You all know that. All the problems in the world are caused by everybody else, never by the United States, because we're a benign hegemon. Well, if we're the good guys and they're the bad guys and they're misbehaving, they're bent on creating a greater Russia, oh my God, this is the 1930s all over again. Any sort of concession to Putin is Munich, October 1938. You can't do that. So what you do is you double down. You get tougher and tougher. Then this brings us to the question of whether we can succeed or not. My argument is you're playing a losing hand. Right? And the reason you're playing a losing hand is because this is a competition between economic considerations and security considerations. The basic mindset of people in the West is that you can punish the Russians economically and they'll throw their hands up. My argument is when security considerations are at stake, when core strategic interests are at stake, and there's no question, ladies and gentlemen, in Russia's case, this is a core strategic interest, countries will suffer enormously before they throw their hands up. Right? So you can inflict a lot of pain on the Russians, and they're not going to quit. And they're not going to quit because Ukraine matters to them. And by the way, Ukraine doesn't matter to us. You understand there's nobody calling for us to fight in Ukraine. Even John McCain, who up until recently has never seen a war he didn't want to fight, right, is not calling for using military force in Ukraine. What John McCain is saying is that Ukraine is not a vital strategic interest for the West. That's what he's saying. It is a vital strategic interest for the Russians. They've made that perfectly clear, and not just Putin. Right? So in terms of the balance of resolve, it's all on their side. And I showed you that slide up there that depicted how much economic leverage the Russians have because of all that natural gas going westward. So we're playing a losing hand here. But let's assume that I'm wrong. Let's assume that we're playing a winning hand and that we are capable of backing Putin into a corner. And we're getting close to pushing him off a cliff. Is this good? You're talking about a country that's got thousands of nuclear weapons. And the only circumstance, really, under which states use nuclear weapons is when they're desperate, when they think their survival is at stake. So what you're talking about is putting Putin in a situation where he's desperate. And if you go home and Google Putin and nuclear brinksmanship, you'll be reading all the articles that come up for the next 2 years, right? Because he's making it clear that you're fooling around with his core strategic interests. And again, he's got thousands of nuclear weapons. So you're putting yourself in a position, right? You're putting yourself in a position where you're willing to risk a possible nuclear war over a piece of real estate, Ukraine, that is not of vital strategic interest to the United States. Again, it's not of vital strategic interest to us. By the way, this will be my final point on this. What's truly amazing about all of this is that we were talking about incorporating Ukraine into NATO when we have now acknowledged by not taking military action over Ukraine that it's not a vital strategic interest. You understand that when you incorporate Ukraine into NATO, you're giving them an Article 5 guarantee, which says you'll come to their defense if they're attacked. You only give Article 5 guarantees to countries that are of vital strategic interest, like Germany during the Cold War. What were we doing, thinking about giving an Article 5 guarantee to a country that's not a vital strategic interest? It just shows you how discombobulated American foreign policy is these days. And of course, the Ukraine crisis is just one of many messes that we've made. As you know, we have the Midas touch in reverse. There's nothing that we do that doesn't go south. Afghanistan, Iraq, Libya, Ukraine, I could go on. So the point I'm making to you is, I do not think that this is going to work, but if it does work, I'm not sure it's a good thing. I had some quotes from the New York Times that really capture what we're doing. I won't leave them up there, but they make it very clear that we're playing hardball with the Russians. This was a Times piece last year that gave a good synoptic version of the Obama administration's thinking on how to deal with this crisis. Now, what should be done? My view is we should create a neutral Ukraine, which is a buffer state between NATO and Russia. Basically, what I'm talking about is going back to the status quo ante, before we got this foolish idea in our head that we could peel Ukraine away from Russia and make it part of NATO, make it part of the EU, make it more generally part of the West. We should work to create a situation where Ukraine is neutral, and it's a buffer state. Just to go back to my simple or simplistic graphic, depending on your views, right? This is how I think about European security. This is what you want. You want NATO to include France, Germany, and Poland. You want Ukraine as a buffer state, and then you want Russia on the eastern flank of that border state. And this is not what you want. You do not want a divided Ukraine where western Ukraine is in NATO, eastern Ukraine is in Russia, and the Russians and the Americans who hate each other at that point are eyeball to eyeball on the Dnieper River. Not a good idea. How do you get to this end? Very simple. Explicitly abandon NATO expansion. By the way, NATO expansion is dead. I've talked to countless policymakers who say this. It's dead. But what we have to do is explicitly abandon it. Say it is not happening. We have to fashion an economic rescue plan for Ukraine that includes Russia, the IMF, and the EU. This, of course, is what Putin wanted to do in 2013, and the EU said no, foolishly. We want to go to great lengths to guarantee minority rights, especially language rights, in Ukraine. This gets back to those maps that I was putting up that show that this is, in very important ways, a civil war, and what we have to do is dampen down the conflict inside Ukraine. We have to give the people in eastern Ukraine a lot of autonomy, and we definitely have to protect minority rights. Are we going to do any of this? No. And I'll talk more about that in a second. Consequences. and this is my last slide, will there be a new Cold War? No. Russia is not the Soviet Union, and as I said to you before, we have a potential peer competitor on the horizon who could be of proportions we've never seen before. The Chinese threat, once it materializes, is going to be something like we've never seen. We're going to have our hands full in Asia. Europe is not going to matter, and Russia is going to be with us. The balancing coalition against China is going to be South Korea, Japan, Vietnam, Taiwan, Singapore, India, and Russia. The Russians will be with us, and that's another reason this whole policy is so stupid, right? What we're effectively doing is driving the Russians into the arms of the Chinese. There's a great strategy. We need the Russians on Iran. We need the Russians on Iran. We drive the Russians closer to the Iranians. You saw where they just sold the Iranians S-300 anti-aircraft missiles. We need the Russians on Syria. We need the Russians on all sorts of issues. We don't need to have a fight with the Russians now. We're not going to have a Cold War. Will the United States still pivot to Asia? Yes. All we need is one big crisis out there. It's coming, probably in the South China Sea, sooner rather than later, if you've been reading the newspapers. And once that happens, we will focus laser-like on Asia, because that's a peer competitor. Russia is not a peer competitor. What are the implications for NATO? This gets back to the previous question. I think that NATO is in serious trouble and will disappear as a functioning alliance over time, in large part because I think we're going to pivot to Asia. What are the implications of all this for our Asian allies? It's a very interesting question. I was in Japan in December of 2014, and the Japanese, like a lot of people in Asia, number one, wonder whether we're going to be there for them, right? Because they see us causing trouble over Ukraine, they see us picking a fight with ISIS, and they say if the United States is fighting ISIS, dealing with the Russians over Ukraine, are they going to be able to pivot to Asia? And then furthermore, they say, even if the United States does pivot, can we trust them? If you look at how this gang operates in Washington, it does look like the gang that can't shoot straight. Do we want to depend on them? If you're Japanese and you're depending on the American security umbrella, especially the American nuclear umbrella, don't you scratch your head and say, can I rely on Washington in a crunch with the Chinese over the Senkaku or Diaoyu Islands? Not clear. So I think this has not been good for our relations with our Asian allies. What are the implications for Iran and Syria? As I said before, remains to be seen. We need the Russians on Iran, we need the Russians on Syria. And you take a stick and you poke the Russians in the eye, and you continue to poke them in the eye, they're going to look for ways to retaliate. And I wouldn't be surprised if somewhere down the road they don't play ball with us on Iran. We don't get a deal with the Iranians. It'd be interesting to see what the Russians then do, see if they're interested in maintaining a sanctions regime. And Syria is a total mess, as you know, and if there's any hope of resolving that, the Russians are going to have to be involved. And again, it's going to be hard to get a lot of cooperation given what's going on over Ukraine. Is Crimea lost to Russia for good? Yep, it's gone. Gone. What are the implications for Ukraine? This is in many ways the most important part of my talk, and I'll just take 2 or 3 minutes, then we can go to Q&A. When I give this talk, many people in the West think that there's sort of a deep-seated immoral dimension to my position because I'm blaming the West and not Putin, who certainly has authoritarian or thuggish tendencies. There's no question about that. But I actually think that what's going on here is that the West is leading Ukraine down the primrose path. And the end result is that Ukraine is going to get wrecked. And I believe that the policy that I'm advocating, which is neutralizing Ukraine and then building it up economically and getting it out of the competition between Russia on one side and NATO on the other side, is the best thing that could happen to the Ukrainians. What we're doing is encouraging the Ukrainians to play tough with the Russians. We're encouraging the Ukrainians to think that they will ultimately become part of the West, because we will ultimately defeat Putin and we will ultimately get our way. Time is on our side. And of course, the Ukrainians are playing along with this. And the Ukrainians are almost completely unwilling to compromise with the Russians and instead want to pursue a hardline policy. Well, as I said to you before, if they do that, the end result is that their country is going to be wrecked. And what we're doing is, in effect, encouraging that outcome. I think it would make much more sense for us to work to create a neutral Ukraine. It would be in our interest to bury this crisis as quickly as possible. It certainly would be in Russia's interest to do so. And most importantly, it would be in Ukraine's interest to put an end to the crisis. Thank you.